To finalize panel four, we want to invite Ignacio Galán. He's a New York-based architect and historian and serves as assistant professor of architecture at Barnard College, Columbia University. His scholarship addresses the relationship between architecture and politics with a particular focus on nationalism, colonialism, and diverse forms of population transience. Please welcome. His talk will be Who is My Neighbor? And that's what Ignacio asks with his presentation.
Hello. So first I want to thank the organizers for putting together this fantastic couple of days. It's been a super relevant conversation and everything was so beautifully organized. So I want to thank them before starting. And since I imagine we are all running low on energy, I thought I would start with a music video.
What if you could make weapons like these in your own home using what's called a three-dimensional printer? This sounds like science fiction, but to some, it's not so far-fetched.
You can dance if you want a little bit. Interiors of a brutalist council state, 3D printers coexist with laminated wood furniture. Maybe we can print it down. Neon colored drones, souvenirs from remote territories, faux animal prints, and leather sofas. It's mid-afternoon, and shots of colorful parrots and capuchin monkeys interweave with scenes of teenagers who sit in front of TVs, displaying international channels, communicate through phones and laptops. They share images with close and distant friends and place orders online. 3D printing alternates with hookah smoking. Jeans and leggings are combined with smiling face printed niqabs. Hoodies with Afro-punk pattern bomber jackets. Japanese kanji tattoos cover arms and backs. These scenes depict a weekday in Peckham, South London, the home of communities with diverse origins from all over England and from East Asia, South Asia, the Caribbean, Africa, the Middle East, and Eastern Europe. The images in this video by MIA exemplify a larger condition. In 2015, at the same time that the European media created the paranoia of the so-called refugee crisis, the online retailing company Alibaba shipped 12.2 billion packages to home addresses in different countries. Hundreds and thousands of 3D printers were purchased. And while migration is on the rise, Instagram contained this year 58 million posts tagged hashtag home. And at present, more than 240 million people are living in places where they were not born, both within domestic settings and in the spaces defined by national boundaries. Being at home has different definitions nowadays under global regimes of circulation of people and goods grounded in changing geopolitical relations, the development of neoliberalism, and the expansion of media technologies. Architecture is in the middle of all these diverse histories of migration and colonialism that intersect in these complex contemporary realities. And since I'm not an expert on the Baltic region, nor am I from here, I thought I would present short pieces of different research, design, and curatorial projects that address these contemporary complex realities in different contexts around the world. And all of them display architecture's entanglement with this question, who is my neighbor, as they define what being at home has been for different communities throughout history. As I say, these scenes are quite diverse, so I'm going to start with a history that brings us back to 19th century New York. And it is in this context that I found the question, who is my neighbor, in an 1889 article authored by photographer and housing activist Jacob Riis. And he posed this question in his analysis of the ways in which Italian migrants lived together in the city of New York at the turn of the century, concerned as he was not only with housing as a housing activist, but also with migration. And he was a migrant himself. His article documented the relation between the internal diversity of Italians living in the city, and you have to understand that Italy was a quite diverse country and a recent nation in the 19th century, and that there he was recording their distribution throughout Little Italy. According to him, Italians of different regions gathered in the same streets in New York in order to support each other. And this distribution was made visible throughout the different through the different saint patrons that each of this group celebrated. And I quote, as San Roque, an important saint in Calabria, rules Mulberry Street, so Thompson Street is preempted by San Anthony of Padua, end quote. And he's associated New York streets with Italian saints. Religious performances and communities of neighborliness were many times consolidated around regional demarcations in different streets, like he's recording. But other times, these religious performances challenged regional divisions and shaped larger social articulations. And particularly important was the Lady of Mount Carmel, which defied the atomization of Italian population along different regions. And I quote again, not only from New York and Brooklyn, but from the far towns of New Jersey and the camps of Connecticut come hosts to kneel at her shrine, the Shrine of the Virgin. In fact, these performances increasingly went from reinforcing regional enclaves and their associated identities to perform a form of belonging to a larger community of national reach, even while that very nation was very small. These populations were away from that nation, and while they were gathering around a virgin who had no relevance in Italy. And I start with these notes because, as you all know, Jacob Riis is one of the fundamental figures documenting the architecture of housing in New York City at the turn of the century, which I've been studying in relation to the different diasporic communities settling in the city, trying to make as close links as possible between architecture and migration. And I'm interested in diasporic communities as part of a larger consideration of the ways in which architecture mediates new ways of being together, characteristic of a life in transit. I am particularly concerned with Italians, since the diasporic migration that followed the Italian unification found constitutes the largest one in modern history today. So more Italians have left the country than in any other modern nation. And this migration found in New York one of its preferred destinations. Interestingly, this dispersion coincided with the rise of Italian nationalism, which was discussed in those terms. We have created Italy, now we have to create the Italians. And inclusions and exclusions to this community, the community of Italians that was being shaped, who was deemed to be Italian and who was excluded from that, were also performed in New York. In fact, Italian migrants in the city were considered to be, and I quote, not Italians, because they've never been Italians. And that's the way, as you can see, in which the manager of the Casa Italiana put it at the end of that period of national consolidation. And at play, as you can see, was the rejection of southern populations in the construction of Italian model citizens at the time, and their simultaneous rejection in New York City, which became at the time the fourth largest city in number of Italians in the world, so only after Rome, Milan, and Naples. And regardless of the legal definition of citizenship, it is the possibility to produce Italians, the idea that they will they wanted to make Italians and to produce non-citizens. They are not Italians. That is made evident here. And I'm particularly interested in the role of architecture and how it plays a role in the granting of citizenship and defining how we live together, particularly considering the relation between certain transformations of housing at the time and the different diasporic communities that were settling in the city during that period. Jacob Rees provided an exceptional chronicle for those transformations with his photographs that are very famous, and his concern with the ways in which the other have lives, and that's the title of his books, situated the tenements in relation to these diasporic communities. In fact, we normally think that the other half was the poorest half, but it was also the diasporic half. In fact, he organized his book in relation to those diasporic communities with chapters dedicated to each of them. And we significantly consider the tenement typology as a quote-unquote natural environment for the reproduction of specific attitudes which were deemed characteristic of each of these communities. And I'm interested in the way in which Rees's response as a housing activist to what he saw as a problematic set of attitudes that these diasporic communities brought to New York. So his response as a housing activist didn't merely concentrate on the technical problems of housing, that's lack of ventilation, lack of space that he displayed in those photographs, but he was also looking at the way in which these communities were living together, particularly committed to normalizing the nuclear family as a way of living in the United States and a privileged social formation for American society. And as you can read here, he said, by far the largest parts of crimes in the city are perpetrated by individuals whose homes have ceased to be sufficiently separate to afford the influences of home and family. So his project was not only to have clean air in the house or more space for these families, but to have houses that shaped families, and so-called normal families in his mind. And if you understand what I'm trying to do is to see how architecture is part of larger conversations regarding assimilation and social normalization that are normally attached to questions of migration. And in response to these arguments, I'm interested in the ways in which the tenements and expanded households that he was criticizing, in fact, provided Italians with networks of support among them that were the way in which they sustained their lives in the city in their virtual lack of citizenship. In fact, some of the evolutions of the tenements you can see resulted in these longer corridors that allow certain rooms in the tenements to open directly to the corridors, and that provided certain semi-private rooms. Certain privacy to these rooms that allow some friends, some boarders, and people that were coming from their same region to be hosted with families living in those apartments. And of course, that led to the overpopulation of those apartments, but it also allowed them to provide each other with support. So I'm trying to look at those networks as the provision of other forms of support that are important for migrant populations. So different types of housing developed at the time could be read along the ways in which I'm reading those housings in relation to the different types of communities they aim to shape and in relation to different forms and practices of citizenship. And while I'm considering these questions as a historian, and I did this historical introduction with this first scene, these questions help illuminate recent trends. So one could ask, for example, what would have happened if the technical questions of housing, let's say a lack of ventilation and a space, would have been separated from the social project aiming to normalize certain ways of being together and would have allowed each community to thrive with their own ways of being together? Could we consider new architectures supporting social formations that challenge the frameworks that link citizenship and neighborliness with the stable frameworks provided by religion, by the family, and by the nation? So these questions are increasingly relevant in our time when the growing circulation of people throughout the world makes our attachments to places and collectivities increasingly fleeting. And the design of housing could be considered increasingly as the provision of shelter for temporary social forms in which both citizenship and the nation are questioned. These are questions that are obvious in the large architecture deployments of refugee camps, among others. And of course, the Syrian diaspora, which is close in numbers to that of Italians, is a clear representation of the destabilizations that accompany these migrations. However, these questions are not only characteristic of those exceptional spaces, but are also key to the way in which we define our coexistence more broadly and the ways in which we define citizenship and neighborliness. Working with the After Belonging Agency, I've been looking at some examples of these destabilizations in Northern Europe, including examples like this, in which the realms of ownership and identity are negotiated within diversity. This apartment is part of a massive program in which the Swedish government set itself to build 1 million residences between 1965 and 1974, aiming to alleviate the housing shortage in its cities. These houses were initially thought for Swedish working class families with 1 to 2 kids, but they include now extremely diverse populations and even more than 85% of migrants, hosting increasingly translocal families and communities with diverse forms of association. So the question, who is my neighbor, is particularly relevant in this context and in relation to the way we analyze these architectures. The homogeneous landscape of blocks surrounded by greenery and the standardized designs of 2 to 3 bedroom apartments hosts now a diversity of occupations. And the abstract sequence of modernist facade now contains this postmodern plantation of satellite antennas that bring remote sounds and images of a global domestic landscape. We've also been looking at architectures specifically purposed for the reception of migrants and refugees, which have arrived in large numbers to Northern Europe in these last years. Asylum seeker centers like this one in Oslo have the capacity for hundreds of individuals and host kids, families, and single adults. And despite its transitory character, some individuals have stayed in these centers for more than 5 years as they await for the resolution of their asylum applications. Their shifting population is an index of current international conflicts, which are replicated in their few square meters. So citizens of opposing factions translate their struggles to the center common spaces. And in the most banal cases, these manifest in who takes over control of music broadcasting or internet bandwidth. But of course, they also manifest in other tensions. Regulations of asylum seeker centers in Norway are entangled within the legal mandate to provide shelter to all its inhabitants. And this shelter is defined in the law as quote-unquote sparse but safe. And that's how Norwegian law defines its mandate to provide shelter to its population. And while these facilities could be operated by NGOs, most are run now by private commercial agents who translate the sparseness of shelter into material economies tied to the fluctuations of the market and link the right to housing with the logics of profit. Understanding architecture as a key infrastructure hosting these temporary networks of neighborliness is key to debate how familiarity is negotiated within diversity as one of the questions that we are faced with today. And these are questions that can be discussed also through design projects, and I incorporated them in a housing project that was developed in response to a call for proposals by the IBA. And this is a project that I developed with the Open Workshop. And the IBA has a long tradition of building housing where migrants are protagonists. And I don't know if you're familiar with Ezra Khan's work on beautiful work and analysis on that relation between the housing developed by the IBA in Berlin and Turkish migration at the time. The call in this case asked to reconcile industrial facilities with housing in the suburban neighborhood of Wilhelmsburg in Hamburg, Germany. And that is a neighborhood that mixes industrial facilities with industrial facilities with housing for populations lacking stability, including migrants and young people, and currently hosts also a large number of refugees. And in part due to this large migration to locations similar to Wilhelmsburg, the notion of residence has become a contentious concept and a disputed context in Germany and in other European locations. With the rise of the far-right parties in Europe, the term Heimat, meaning both home and homeland, has channeled many of these discussions in Germany. And according to a local journalist, in the recent regional elections last fall, every party allegedly claimed the term Heimat for themselves. But I'm also interested in scenes like this, taking place in this very neighborhood where Javad Sarenpour, an Iranian refugee, is being hosted by an aging family to which he provides care. And our project speculates on architecture's capacity to grant these populations with recognition, the different populations inhabiting the neighborhood, without equating necessarily recognition with property, and aims to facilitate networks of support among them. And in order to facilitate these networks, the project considers a series of spatial relations and forms of collective management, supporting different types of co-housing and work cooperatives. So the project proposes a key typological operation by combining the perimeter block with housing all along the street in the three blocks that constitute the development, and big box architecture with industrial spaces in the center of each of these blocks. And in addition to these different spatial configurations, we also define a clear protocol for the negotiations that would necessarily take place among the different agents participating in this development. So a series of circuits, here in red, you can see them host the relations between these different spaces of production and reproduction and brings them together with uses that would be collectively defined within the previously established frameworks. And with these strategies, the project considers architecture's participation in the provision of individuals with recognition, triggers diverse forms of encounter, and facilitates different networks of support among its inhabitants. And while I'm trying to explore different relations between architecture and diverse social forms, I'm also wary of attempts to establish deterministic relationship between the forms of architecture and the forms of society. And still, I'm interested in the way in which spatial relations articulated with specific management systems might trigger material links, affinities, and collaborations that are behind new forms of being together. The hope is that the belonging in this project would not be based on common identities, but could rather relate to what Paolo Virno describes as belonging as such, new forms of association that might not be predicated on shared essences or property relations. And the notion of belonging is one that I've been considering during the last years with the After Belonging Agency, with hope of problematizing architecture's concern with our changing attachments to places and collectivities. And our hope is that the project is also challenging how we discuss architecture in relation to these complexities and, in fact, going beyond the building. So this project, which we presented as a curatorial framework for the Oslo Architecture Triennale 2016, locates the discussion on the architectures of residence that I've been addressing, both physical residence like housing, but also legal residence, i.e. the nation, within a broader concern with the processes of dissolution and disembedding of social relations on the one hand, and the search for different forms of binding and belonging on the other. And we are interested in belonging as a contentious affiliation, one that is being defined by what different theories have discussed as the disjunctures or the freak displacements or frictions of the contemporary world, which are increasingly relevant to address the architectures of housing today. In fact, this concern requires understanding that architecture is part of complex networks in which migration, for example, is enmeshed in economic flows as remittances, for example, transfers of capital from migrants to family members staying in their home countries. diverse architectures are being designed today all throughout the world that are not so much concerned with housing people, but rather are occupied by dreams and aspirations of transnational families and communities with the aspiration to return being just one among them. Here you have an example of Little Oslo, a neighborhood that acts as the Pakistani mirror of Little Karachi, located in Norway. But the architectures of belonging are today also mediated by commercial platforms that promise that you can belong anywhere, like Airbnb does. But this, of course, we know is a naive version of belonging that is unaware of the legal difficulties that many have to settle anywhere. The operations of this platform are critically intervened by architecture. You can see here, for example, the idea of homeliness promoted by different design strategies and its conflict with the logics of the housing market. The platform, in fact, is leading to the displacement of communities in different cities and results in flows that are not unrelated to diverse forms of migration throughout the world. Architecture is at the center of other forms of population transfer. We result from big transformations of the systems that define European communities. Consider, for example, this hotel, the Hotel Reumasol, located in the Spanish coast, that hosts mostly Norwegian pensioners, which come to enjoy the benefits of the sun in the treatment of their illnesses. And interestingly, it functions as part of the Norwegian welfare network that they are so proud of. Now it has a network that has been exported outside its boundaries. And these are migrations from the north to the south, just to put examples of all kinds of migrations as part of this conversation. Despite the architecture of the center being designed in so-called Spanish vernacular, pensioners are constantly reminded of their Norwegian cultures and traditions, both in the menu, serving the hotel's buffet, and in the grocery store, where they are surrounded by tastes and traditions that make them, quote-unquote, feel at home within Norwegian culture and traditions within Spanish soil. These were some of the examples that helped us frame the curatorial framework of the Oslo Architecture Triennale that I was mentioning before in 2016, which included several exhibitions, two of which you have in the screen, but also included conferences and events where these questions that we are discussing today and yesterday were dealt with in its complexity. We also produce a publication which documents the curatorial project, but also try to advance the conversations that continue to concern us. The projects that were included in this project were very diverse and addressed different aspects of these questions that I'm attempting to highlight. But they all asked us to expand what we understand as architecture's interventions in relation to the logics of migration. This was the case, for example, of this project developed by Norwegian couple Eriksen Skaya, who intervened in the asylum seeker center that I presented before. And their intervention looked at the orchard that surrounds the center as a key space where new forms of belonging are being crafted. And I'm going to play another video.
Okay, stop.
Det vi lager en eplepresse for å lage eplemos av alle eplene som eplelaget.
Okay.
So their project consisted on building an apple press as a critical architecture to intervene in the relation among spaces and collectivities that are being crafted in this center. And I find this a rather optimistic project, but one that shows also the disciplinary expansion that is needed to address the architectures of migration today. This optimism is also embedded in the title, After Belonging. In fact, we called it after, not to indicate a posterior condition, how we live now that there's no belonging, but rather to convey a pursuit, the pursuit for new forms of being together that respond to a life in transit. So all these different scenes that I showed today address architecture's challenges in today's increasingly transient world as they explore the critical question that concerns Jacob Riis, and that is the one also that is still at the core of our new ways of being together today, one that MIA beautifully captures in her video, but one that is also behind the construction of an apple press, the question, who is my neighbor? So thank you very much.